Welcome.
Whoa, yeah, that's on.
Welcome, everyone. I think we'll go ahead and get started. Starting to lose my voice, but I'm being mic amplified, so you'll be able to hear me. All right. So this evening we have Nick Ladd here to speak with us, and so what I'd like to do is open with prayer, and then let him get started very shortly. So let's pray together. God, we thank you for this meal at the end of the day here, the end of a beautiful day. But we know that the day is not so beautiful in some parts of this country. Pray for those who are in the midst of the hurricane that's coming. Thank you that Howard and Tammy were able to get here before that came. Thank you for Nick, who's willing to come and share the Heilsgeschichte story with us. Thank you for the faithful teachers at Heslin College who have taught that for years, and pray for meaning that it has in students' lives. Thank you for that. Thank you for our time together now. In Jesus' name, amen. So Nick has been teaching at Heslin College for 7 years, he said. He's told me. I remember when he was a student there a while ago. He and his family came here, and that was when we were still out doing WOW, and we had at least one or two of your kids at our table that I remember. For a while, and he teaches biblical literature and is one of the campus pastors. And if you teach other classes, I should know that. Okay, I knew that peacemaking and justice. Yeah, I did know that. He is also involved helping with the soccer team, the men's soccer team, a little bit. So if you go to the soccer games, you'll see him out there. But thank you, Nick, for being willing to join us this evening. And well, there you get started.
Thanks, Dallas. Oh, man. You guys are just like my college students. So before I start, I'm going to ask you all to move forward before you get too comfortable, especially you guys in the center. You want to move up a little bit. You don't want to be back so far. Oh, my goodness. Yeah. Thanks. Hey, Peter. Oh boy, Marion's not here though. Howard, did you ever teach? You taught Biblit? Yeah. Okay, I was thinking that you did. Yeah. How many of you, before I start, how many of you are Heslin grads? Did you go to Heslin College? Some of you, okay. Okay, yeah. And how many of you took Biblit and said the Heils? I know some of you did, yeah. Okay, good. Wow, okay. Yeah, well, thanks. Oh, there he is. I thought. Marion, it occurred to me on the way here tonight that I was like, oh man, I bet Marion might be there. I don't know that I've ever done this in front of Marion, although he's come to sat in on classes, and that's always a treat to have him there. So Marion, if you don't know, Marion developed this course in the Heilsgeschichte many, many moons ago, and we maybe have adjusted it slightly and in a little bit, tweaked it a little bit along the way, but it's still pretty much the same way as he developed it back in the 80s. So yeah. Without Marion, I wouldn't be here, and literally probably wouldn't be here. So one of the reasons I always take the chance when Howard emailed me and asked me if he'd be interested, there's no hesitation for me to come share the Heils with people in the groups, because it really did literally save me, I think, as a 30-something-year-old going through the pastoral ministries program. I thought I knew a lot about the Bible and about God. And it wasn't very long into Marion's class that I realized I didn't really know much at all. And I didn't know nearly as much as what I thought I did. And so, yeah, it's just been really instrumental in my life. We left after I went through the pastoral ministries program. We went back to Michigan, where I pastored for 4 years. And ended that time in a pretty dark place and pretty depressed and yeah, not doing very well in many ways, but coming back here and teaching Biblit again and doing the Heils hey, has really like saved me again, and it's brought me back to God. And so what some of you maybe notice, and no, I have the timeline, yeah, I don't know, Marion, yeah, on my arm, because it's just really been significant, and it's that important to me. So I did not grow up Mennonite. I grew up in a Christian, non-denominational church, but very Baptist theologically. So a lot of the things that Marion and Michelle were teaching me in the pastoral ministries program hit pretty hard at first. I loved it, but it also, it was hard to swallow at times. But by the end, especially by the end of Hiles, I just found something new that I never had before. And it was, I found a God that actually loved me the way I am and for who I am, and loved all of us from the beginning, and is still loving us, and that's really the point. God created us out of love. God wants us to love ourselves and love others, and that's a bit different of a message than what I grew up with. And so that's part of the reason I love doing Hiles and sharing Hiles with you. And so just wanted to give you a little bit of that background. But as you guys are going through on Wednesday nights, Howard said you're studying the Bible, you're doing some different types of Bible study. So I think this will help you as you understand, if you understand the whole overarching timeline, then it helps you understand when you're studying individual books and individual themes within that, where they fit and what God's doing. So there's a couple things on the timeline that I always like to talk about before I start the story. Is down here we have the three questions. What is the sin problem? What's God doing to solve the sin problem? And how faithfully are God's people cooperating? So those three questions are questions that we could ask and answer like for the overarching whole story, but they're also questions that we could ask at any point within the story. Does that make sense? So at any time, we could stop and say, you know, what's God doing here? What's the sin problem? What's God doing? What are the people, how faithfully are the people cooperating? Does that make sense? So those three questions, I think, are pretty important and help us to process it. Across the top, I'll be honest, when I took Biblet with Marion, I didn't pay a whole lot of attention to these boxes at the top. And the more that I've learned it and the more that I've spent time with it, these boxes at the top, I think, are the whole key, really, for me, to understanding and putting the whole story together. So the boxes at the top kind of connect the whole, this is the overarching story right here. The timeline then are the details that fill in. So, yeah, pay attention to the box at the top as we go. The stars and the asterisks are like crisis or turning points, really important time periods or really important events that happen along the way. Yeah, I would also say if you have questions, I love interacting. One of the problems when Howard said an hour, I have a really hard time doing it in an hour because I love asking questions and I love interacting. So I will try and get through the whole thing in an hour, and if we don't get every last detail, I'm okay with that. But if there's questions along the way that you have, please feel free to ask, stop me and ask a question, because if you have that question, I want to answer that and make sure that you're with me and that you understand what you want to for tonight, okay? All right, so in the beginning, we start here with problem defined, and in the beginning, God created order out of chaos with the spoken word dabar. So dabar is a Hebrew word that basically means once it's spoken, it comes into being. And the creation stories, stories, which again, I didn't really realize or recognize. And honestly, the first time Marion said it, I was like, he's crazy. There's two creation stories in Genesis. I've read Genesis by the time, you know, over and over, because when you start reading the Bible through in a year, you start in Genesis. And even if you don't finish, you always read Genesis, right? But there's two creation stories in Genesis, Genesis 1 and Genesis 2. They're not quite the same. They don't quite line up. They give us different pictures of God and who God is, but both of them are unique in that God creates peacefully. God speaks, and things come into being. God creates with Dabar. And we'll connect Dabar to Jesus later on, but that's different than most other ancient creation stories, because most ancient creation stories have some element of violence, right? Two gods fight, and then something, they cut the belly open of one of them, and out pops the earth. So there are lots of ancient creation stories. The creation stories that we find in Genesis are unique in that they're peaceful, and I think that represents the type of God that created us. a peaceful creation. God spoke with Dabar and comes into being. Not very long, and he calls creation good and calls humans very good. So we are good part of creation. We are created for good and to be good. It's not long after, though, that we get to the fall stories. So these four lines on your timeline represent four stories. They go down because sin keeps getting worse each time. So you probably know some of these, right? What's the first, what would you call the first fall story? Adam and Eve. Yeah. Adam and Eve, right? So they eat of the fruit and that they aren't supposed to. And then could you guess what the second fall story might be connected to Adam and Eve? Marion, you can't answer. Cain and Abel. Good. Cain and Abel. And then still in Genesis, a couple chapters later, the whole earth is filled with violence. And God decides to do what? Yeah, send the flood. Yeah, Noah's Ark and the flood. And then after that, a little maybe lesser known, but the people are trying to make a name for themselves and get all the way up to heaven, so they want to build Tower of Babel. Good. Tower of Babel, yeah. So each of these four stories in Genesis represent sin and the problem of sin, and each of those represents what we say, how we define sin, is broken relationships in four different areas. And we see it most clearly in the Adam and Eve story, but it's in all four of those. There's four different areas in which sin breaks relationships. So between us and God, us and ourselves, us and others, us and all creation. Marion taught me that 15 years ago, and I still do it, and I make my students do it every time. So why does it matter how we define sin? Does it matter how we define the problem? Is sin just something that we do, a rule that we break, that God gave us, and we break a rule? That's one way to define sin. Is that fair? Do some people think of, that's the way I thought of sin for 30 years. God has this list of rules. If I break that rule, then I've committed a sin. Anything that God says not to do is a sin. And I think that that's true, but is sin? It's what is the result of sin? It's broken relationships. It makes it a little bit broader. We define sin a little bit broad in breaking relationships. So it's not just, the problem with that definition, I would say it only connects or it only deals with one relationship, us and God. But how many of you know some people who say they're saved and they're Christians and yet they are mean and ornery and grumpy and not happy people? I know some. It's not Bill, but I do know some. Right? Does God want to heal us and our inner selves? Does God want to heal our relationships with other people also? Does God want to heal our relationship with the whole earth? That's a bit more broad, right? So if that's what God, if the sin problem, it's important to define the sin problem, because once we define the sin problem, then that helps us also to define the solution. Does that make sense? So if the problem is only breaking a relationship with God, I just broke a rule, then I only have to fix that one relationship. If, on the other hand, sin is breaking relationships in all four of these areas, then the solution better address all four of those areas, right? So it's a little bit broader than what I grew up, for sure. So the four fall stories. Then we get to the patriarchs and matriarchs, and there's four sets of patriarchs and matriarchs, and this is where we get the solution promised. So if you have your Bibles, I always like to do this just so that you can see that I'm not making it up, and if you don't, that's fine, or if you want to pull it up. But I go to Genesis 12, Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 to 3. Again, I would say, I don't know, that first semester was rough for me. Because when Marion read this, I like almost wanted to get up and walk out of class because I just didn't believe that this was true, but yet it was right there in front of me. But Genesis 12, 1 to 3 is where we get the calling, Abraham's calling. Okay? Genesis, Abram originally, right? And who becomes Abraham and Sarah are originally Abram and Sarai. So this in 12, 1 to 3, you can listen or you can follow along, but I want you to listen. This is Abraham's calling and blessing. What's the purpose? What does God want to do with Abraham? Okay? Genesis 12:1-3. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Does God want to make Abraham and his descendants into a great and mighty nation and make them great? Yeah. Why does God want to make Abraham into a great nation? Just so that everybody will be like, ooh, that's Abraham. They're the Abramites. They're so cool. No? Why does God? It's twice in here. It says it twice. Anybody pick it up? So, yes, to be blessed. At the end of verse 2 and at the end of verse 3, both. So the verse 2 is, I'll make you into a great nation, I'll bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I'll bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. All the families of the earth shall be blessed. So why do we care that the solution promise starts with a family group, and God calls this family group to work with them in a special way to bless all families of the earth? That's so, so important, and so many Christians miss that very beginning in Genesis 12, and that changes the way we read the whole rest of the Bible. It changes the whole thing. If you miss this in Genesis 12, it's not that it's only in Genesis 12, but if you miss it here, then you ignore it every place else. God said, I want to bless you and make you great so that you can be a blessing to others, so that all the families of the earth will be blessed. So, my atheist friends who say, I want nothing to do with the Bible or with God because it's just one people group's story and their God. That's what I hear a lot from atheists. And I didn't used to have, before I took BibLit, I didn't have a very good answer for that. Because that's really what I thought also. That's pretty much the Old Testament, right? God works with the Israelites. God loves the Israelites. I thought they were kind of right. Until I saw this, and then you connected that to everything else in the Old Testament. It's not just about the Israelites. It's not. God called them. God blessed them. God wants them to do something special to bless all families of the earth. So we say God called them. They're chosen for a mission, not to be God's favorites. Chosen for a mission, not to be God's favorites. Hate to preach too much, but does that matter all the way right now to 2024? If you don't think that matters, I don't think you're watching the news. Does that verse and that way we look at the Bible impact what's happening in our world right now today? It 100% does. Who's providing almost every single bullet and ammunition and fighter jet and technology for Israel to destroy people right now, their neighbors? Us, the U.S. Why? Because we as a people, as a country, as a Christian nation, believe that God called Abraham and wanted to bless him and be his special favorite people for all times. Yeah? So my family, my parents, and my siblings, and most of my aunts and uncles and grandparents all would have believed this same thing. They all still support, they think Israel's doing great things and it's all good. And we need to support them 100% because of this. Because God does. So we can't be against Israel, right? Because God wants Israel to be great. But why does God want Israel to be great? To bless all families of the earth. Do you see how that changes? For me, it changed everything. That one thing completely changed everything for me. Changed my faith, turned me upside down. My mom says the Mennonites ruined me. I could really just say it was Marian, but it's really, I don't think I'm ruined. I think it's pretty awesome, and I love the faith that I have learned, and it's much better for me than believing that way. So, patriarchs and matriarchs, there's four families, Abraham and Sarah, Isaac and Rebekah, Jacob, Leah, and Rachel, and then Joseph and Asenath. So they all work at this solution promised, and God's trying to create a chosen covenant shalom people out of all people groups. So basically, God, through Abraham, is trying to create this people that will bless all peoples of the earth. Shalom, I think, is the word in there that most of us think we kind of know but don't quite know all of. What would you say if I said, what does the word shalom mean? What would some of you say? What's your first, like, peace, peace. Yeah, right, peace. And it does mean peace, but it's more than just, like, peace as the absence of war or violence. Shalom is like a really deep peace. Shalom is when everything is in right relationship with each other. The best example of shalom goes all the way back here to the garden, right? When everything is working in right relationship with each other. So God is trying to create a shalom people group out of all people groups that will do that same thing, that will love each other, that will take care of each other, that will work together, that will feed the poor and the hungry and work together. So he's trying to create this people group. The last group there is Joseph. And Joseph, most of you know the Joseph story or a good chunk of it. Joseph, his brothers love him a lot. No. Oh, no. I got the wrong story. All right. Joseph, his brothers hate him. They try to kill him or think about killing him. They sell him into slavery, right? He goes to Egypt, but eventually God gives him the ability to interpret dreams. And Joseph interprets the dream of the Pharaoh, right? And that there's going to be 7 bad years, 7 good years. Everything comes to being. The Pharaoh puts him in charge because he's the one that interpreted the dream. And so eventually the famine does come and it's really bad. And Joseph's brothers come looking for food because they hear that Egypt has food. They have no idea that their brother is in power in Egypt, right? And if you want to talk about a story of forgiveness and a powerful story? Every time I read Joseph and think about it and think really deeply about it, I'm like, I don't know how he did it. They tried to kill him. They beat him up. They threw him in a pit. They sold him to slavery to some people they had no idea, right? Then they come on their knees begging for food and bowing to him. Man, I got to tell you, if it was me, I'd be tempted to just be like, you dirty rats. I ain't giving you any food. Get out of here. But Joseph doesn't do that, right? Joseph does eventually give them food, and eventually the Pharaoh finds out it's his brother and his family, and his father's still alive, and so they all move to Egypt, right? That's a key part of the story. They move to Egypt, but not long after Joseph, Jeff, you should probably give me a time something because I'm just going to go like for 5 hours. Holy smokes. Okay. I'll go. I told you it's hard for me to do. Okay. So Joseph, they all move into Egypt. And what happens after they're there for a while in Egypt? What is the Pharaoh, the new Pharaoh, does what with Joseph and his family? Enslaves them, right? They go into slavery. So, one thing I forgot to tell you about the timeline. Generally, anything on the timeline, if it goes down, it's bad. If it goes up, it's good. Okay? So this represents slavery here, our first crisis point. So the people are enslaved. It seems like it's kind of maybe the end of the story of the people of God because they're not really, they're slaves. They're not really blessing very many people. They're barely staying alive themselves, right? So eventually the story of Moses comes, and Moses comes and delivers them out of Egypt, the cool burning bush story, and Moses is saved as a baby, as an infant in the water. But eventually they come, and Moses eventually leads the people out of Egypt. And here again is another cool thing that connects with this, Genesis 12, 1-3. But if you don't see this, again, you don't see this here in Egypt. Who comes out of Egypt with Moses? Anybody know? Is it just the Israelite slaves? Well, I know somebody knows. No, it's not just the Israelite slaves. God tells Moses that bring anybody who wants to come with you. The last plague, right? The plagues are the miracles that God does through Moses. And the last one is the Passover, the angel of death. And is it just the Israelite slaves that get the warning to put blood on the doorpost? No, it's all of Egypt. Like the Egyptians get the same warning. They can put blood on the doorpost too if they choose to. And some of them did. And by the time, but Pharaoh didn't. And when he loses his firstborn and says, get out of here, the people leaving, it says in Genesis, is a mixed crowd. It's a mixed crowd of people. Why is that important that it's a mixed crowd? Again, we could jump right over it and just think, God rescued the Israelites from slavery. But God didn't only rescue the Israelites. It was a mixed crowd of people. Anybody who wanted to come. Other slaves and even free Egyptians. Why does that matter? Because God wants to bless who? All families of the earth. All people, right? If God only cared about the Israelites, then when they came out of Egypt, I'm convinced that God would have told Moses, only bring the Israelite slaves. That's it. If God only cared about the descendants of Abraham, he would have said, don't bring anybody else except the pure descendants of Abraham. That is not what he says. Bring anybody that wants to come with you. So they come out of Egypt as a mixed crowd and a mixed group of people. We say the solution is promised here with the patriarchs and matriarchs. It doesn't begin until Exodus and Sinai because until this point, it really is mostly only one people group. It's one family. But here at Exodus, we get a mixed people. It's a mixed crowd. So finally, it's a chosen covenant shalom people out of all people groups because there's a mixed crowd coming with them. Is it perfect? Everything's good after they leave the after they leave Egypt? No, not quite. But they are a mixed crowd, and the solution begins. So they go to Mount Sinai, and at Mount Sinai, Moses goes up to the top, and he comes back down from the mountain with two stone tablets that most of us call what? Ten Commandments. We don't call them the Ten Commandments. We call them the 11 words. Was it just because Marion couldn't count? He got off? Marion, I'm so glad you're here. Okay, it's not because Marion couldn't count. What before the Ten Commandments, it starts with, I am the Lord your God. I am the one who brought you out of the house of slavery, out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. Why does that matter? Because it says God rescued the people. And because God rescued the people out of love, God wanted them. Now you do these things. So we call them the 11 words to remember that there's a first, a word of grace, before the law or the commandments. A word of grace, and then law or commandments. That's another cool pattern that you can see over and over and over again. Law before commandments. Again, why does that matter? Because a lot of us grow up thinking the Old Testament especially is just about rules, rules, rules. Do's and don'ts. Maybe the whole Bible, a lot of us think that. It changes, at least it did for me, and it changes if you see it's not about the rules, it's not about the do's and don'ts. It's, I love you, I rescued you, and now if you believe that I actually love you, then do these things. So why do we do those things? Why do we follow the Ten Commandments? Why do we try and do those things? Because we're afraid God's going to strike us dead if we don't? No, out of gratitude and thankfulness, because God loves us first and acted first. So we call them the 11 words, because God acts first in grace, and then we respond out of gratitude, out of thankfulness. Then we leave Mount Sinai, we get to wilderness wanderings. They go to the promised land. They're on the edge of the promised land. Moses sends in 12 spies, right? You all know this story? Yes? You all know this story, right? They send in the 12 spies. They all come back. The land is great, right? Woo! That's such good land, Moses. You were right. God brought us to the best place possible. Okay, let's go in. Whoa, whoa, whoa. There's giants in there, Moses. We aren't going there. Right? 10 of them say, nah, we're not going there. Let's go back to Egypt. What? You were slaves in Egypt, right? You know that. Oh, yeah, but those giants said they're going to kill us. But we don't want to do that. So, this is another cool thing. Does God force us to do things we don't want to do? I just don't think so. So, God says, look, you don't want to go in? Okay. You can listen, and Moses is a servant leader. Moses says, all right, if you don't want to go in, we won't. Then God says, because you don't want to go in, you don't trust me yet, you're going to wander in the wilderness for 40 years. And all of the adults over 20 are going to die in the wilderness in these 40 years. Is this just punishment? Man, there's just all these patterns. Is this just punishment? Again, you can think of the Old Testament as God just rules, punishment, rules, punishment. Is it just a punishment, or is there something good about the wilderness wanderings for 40 years? Maybe, perhaps, think about this. For several generations, they had been what in Egypt? Slaves. Is it really great that they're free now? Sure, but are they ready to govern and rule and make good decisions every day? If you and your parents and your grandparents and your great-grandparents had woke up every morning and been told what to do every single day of your life, and now you get to wake up and choose what to do, are you going to make really great decisions right off the bat? Maybe not. Maybe not. So maybe judgment and grace, we say judgment and grace go together. Sometimes they're the same thing, sometimes they're opposites, but judgment and grace come together, and this is one of those examples. The wilderness, the 40 years, I think, was grace. It was helping them become a chosen covenant Shalom people group in those 40 years. So there's four learnings that they learn in the wilderness that God teaches them to worship out of gratitude. So again, why do we worship God? Out of thankfulness and out of gratitude. And we learn Deuteronomy 26, the covenant recital, which is the passage that they would come when they would bring an offering to the priest. They would recite this passage. It's a pretty long passage. And at the end, it says, "Now I bring the first of the fruit of the ground that you, O Lord, have given me." But why do they bring offerings and sacrifices to God? Most of the passage, all of it above, "A wandering Aramean was my ancestor who went down into Egypt and lived there as an alien, few in number, and there became a great nation," blah, blah, blah. It's all about what God has done for them. And then at the bottom, "Now I bring the first of the fruit of the ground that you, O Lord, have given me." So why do we bring sacrifices to God? Out of gratitude, out of thankfulness for what God has done. Do you see that? Do you see that it's the same pattern as Mount Sinai, the 11 words, right? The 11 words, it's just a tiny bit of grace at the beginning and then a whole bunch of rules. When we get here, it's kind of the opposite. In the wilderness, with Deuteronomy 26, there's a whole bunch of grace. God has done all these things for you, so now I'm going to bring the first of the fruit of the ground that you've given me. The other really cool thing about the first fruits that they give to the priests, so the priests are the tribe of Levi, and they don't, like, gather food, they don't hunt, they don't get farmland when they do settle down and get land, because they're taking care of the Ark of the Covenant and the tabernacle and doing the priestly things, right? So the sacrifices, the food that's brought in, they get to eat that food. But there's so much food that that's more than they can eat and more than they need. So what goes, where does the rest of the food go after the Levites have had their fill? What happens to the rest of the food? The aliens! The Martians get it. No, not the Martians. Oh. The widows, the orphans, and the aliens among you. The aliens. Again, if you think this stuff doesn't matter, the aliens, the immigrants, are supposed to get the food. If God didn't care, if God only cared about Abraham and his descendants, would he have said here, "Hey, make sure you take care of the illegal, undocumented people that are coming to be a part of you"? I don't think he would have. Are you with me? Whew, sorry, I might be stepping on some toes, but sorry, not sorry. God said, "Feed them, take care of them, clothe them." It's true. Do this with your sacrifices that you're bringing to me. And why are you bringing sacrifices? Because you're afraid that I'm going to kill you if you don't bring sacrifices? No. Why? Because I did all these things for you, and now you know that I love you, and now I'm bringing my first fruits to you to give to you. Yeah? So there's four other learnings, but I'm going to keep going because of time. So eventually they get done with the wandering. They go into the promised land. Oh, thanks. Okay. Oh, perfect. Okay, good. Is that accurate-ish? Okay. so they're done with their 40 years of wandering. Moses dies. Joshua becomes their leader, which was one of the two good spies, right? Joshua becomes the leader, leads them in to the promised land now, and we have infiltration, conquest, revolution. These three words represent three groups of people. Three groups of people. This is one thing where I'd like to change this, and I haven't yet, but I want to change the order of them, Marion, so that it's C-I-R instead of I-C-R, because conquest is the first group. It's the group coming into and conquering the land. It's the people that have been wandering around in the wilderness for 40 years, right? Does that make sense? So there's one group of people. The infiltration people are another group of people. They're basically distant relatives, cousins. They're Abraham descendants also that either left Egypt before they were enslaved, or maybe never came to Egypt in the first place. But at any rate, they're living out here, their second, third, sixth, eighth, ninth cousins, and they're like, oh, you're worshiping the God of Abraham, but that's our God too. Oh, let's join up. The last group is Revolution Group. Revolution is the poor people in the land of Canaan, the poorest of the poor, the low society, like slaves, servants. They see this new people group coming in. They see how they're treating the people. They're working together, and they're like, ooh, let's take this chance to revolt against our masters and go join them. So now, again, there's three kind of main groups of people all joining in, right? Again, does that matter? We could kind of skip over that, but if we connect it back to everything else, right? God created us out of love. God called Abraham to be a blessing to all family people, all families of the earth. When they came out of Exodus, out of Egypt, they were a mixed crowd, a mixed group of people. And now God's saying, hey, there's all these other people they want to join. Go ahead, join in. So Joshua sees all these people that he's leading, and he's like, whoa, a lot of these people don't know the story. They don't know why we're worshiping God, and they keep trying to worship these other idols. So he takes them all to Shechem. How many of you have seen, maybe even you have in your house, this nice, cute little verse that says something about, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord? Have you seen that in people's houses? Yes? Yeah. It's a good verse, right? That's where this comes from, is here. Joshua leads these three groups of people to Shechem, that's a place, and he tells Hiles, it's not very long yet, not compared to what we do, but he basically tells Hiles everything he knows about God and what he's done for the people, and then he says, here I am, me and my family, we're going to serve God, what would you like to do? As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord, what do you want to do? It's up to you. If you want to follow us, then we're going to serve God, and we're going to leave all that other stuff behind. Yeah? So we choose this day who we're going to follow. Then it gets a little complicated and dicey as we keep trying to settle down in the promised land. Notice the timeline changes the circles. That's not just an accident or because Marion got bored and started scribbling. The circles represent what we call the DH or the judges cycles. So this is where we start to have judges. Do you remember, some of you remember, do any of you remember a judge that you can, a story about a judge from the Old Testament? Any, just shout out a name of a judge that you remember. Gideon. Good. Anybody else? Deborah. Who said Deborah? Deborah. Wait, was that a woman? That couldn't have been a woman, right? God doesn't use women in leader. Deborah was a woman, and she was a judge. God called her, and she worked very faithfully. Don't buy it that women are not called by God to lead. They were all the way back here. Judges. Okay, good. So this is where they come in, the judges, right? Gideon, Deborah, Samuel, all of those we call the cycle because it's not really a great system if we're being honest, but it's the best system they have. Who's their king? Did they crown Moses? I was thinking I said Noah, the wrong one, but I was the right one. Moses. Did they crown Moses king at Sinai? Does Moses become their king? Does Joshua become their king? Who's their king? They have a people group without a king? God is their king. God is their king. We call it theocracy when God is king. So they did have a king. It was God. They didn't have a human king, which was crazy and weird, right? So every time they had a problem, this is circles because it represents a cycle. And in this time period, if you read Kings, the books of Kings and Judges, you'll see this cycle over and over and over again. And if you start in Judges and you read 1 and 2 Kings, you're going to think, if you read straight through, you're going to be like, man, I thought I heard that before. Man, I have whiplash because didn't I read that? Yeah, you did, because it's all meshed together and it's not in perfect linear order like this timeline is. But the cycle is the judge, like the people stray, they worship other gods, and then they cry out to God and they're like, hey, what's going on? Somebody conquers them. Sorry, one of their enemies conquers them. Then they cry out to God. And God says, okay, I'll raise up a judge to rescue you. So the judge, God calls a judge, like Gideon, to come and rescue you, to fight the enemy. So judges are primarily military leaders during this time. They're primarily military leaders, not like sitting in a courtroom judge is what we think of today. They're primarily military leaders. So God does some act of holy war with them. They win, they defeat their enemies, and as long as the judge is alive, they pretty much follow God and listen to the judge. But when the judge dies, the pattern starts over again. Yeah? The pattern starts over again. And it also says with each generation it gets worse. So by the time we get here to 1020, the people start asking for a human king. Samuel is the last judge who becomes the first prophet, which we'll talk about in a second. They ask for a human king. Again, does God force his will, God's will, on us? Does God make us do things that we don't want to do? I just don't think it's biblical to say that God does that, because I just don't see it. God gives us choices. God gives us options. And here's another one of those. People say we want a human king. God says to Samuel, the judge, tell the people you don't really want a human king. A human king is going to take your daughters to be in his harem. He's going to take your sons to work for him and be in his army. He's going to take your money. He's going to take your land. You don't want a human king. You're basically going to be back into slavery if you choose a human king. The people are like, no, we want a human king. Everybody else has a king. We want a king. So God's like, okay, you can have a king. So here we see two different strands of the story. And again, this is one of the parts in Biblia when I was going through the first time, I was like, I don't think so, Marion. That can't be right. Because he tried to tell me, and I see now, if you read again in this time period, there's basically two different strands in the Bible. And one is pro-monarchy. It seems like God is okay and wants human kings. And the other one is very anti-monarchy. God does not want it. Like Samuel saying, you shouldn't have a king. But then God chooses and anoints the king, right? So the first king is who? Anybody know? David, Saul. Yeah, so Saul is the first king. So again, one of those examples is, it sounds like God called and anointed him. He has Samuel anoint him. But where is Saul when they go to crown him king? He's hiding back in a closet with a bunch of luggage. He's scared to death. Does that sound like a big, powerful, mighty leader? If God was all about, and the prophets were all about, the kings are good, I don't think we would have that story in there. Right? So we say, what did I tell you about with a timeline? When things go down, it's bad, and when it goes up, it's good. So we drop this way down here because United Monarchy, we say, is a net, it's a bad. And everything else, which this, again, changes the whole rest of the Old Testament, this is God's remedial will. The rest of the Old Testament. Because God's first will or first choice was this, for God to be king. Yeah? And the people chose a human king, so we drop down here. So this dashed line represents prophets. We don't have prophets in the story until we get human kings. There's no prophets in the Old Testament until we get human kings. Why? Because the prophet's main job was to challenge the kings, to challenge their power, to challenge their oppressive acts, to keep this idea of a chosen covenant, shalom people group of all people groups alive. That's why we don't have prophets until then. The kings, Saul, David, Solomon are the three kings during this United Monarchy time. There's two boxes here on the timeline. And again, this is part of why we say this is a big fall, is because of these two boxes. When they choose a human king, they choose also to create a nation state or a country instead of just being a people out of all people groups. And when you have a nation state, what's one of the things you do? You create a border. So they create a border around their country, and they say, they also create a box around the God and say, if you want to worship our God, you have to live within our border. You have to live within this area. Otherwise, you can't really follow our God. And the nation state box, which basically is, if you want to worship God, you have to be one of us. You have to be a citizen of our nation state. So, Ron, you weren't born here in Israel? Sorry, you can never be one of, God doesn't love you as much as God loves Dallas, who was born here in Israel. Never. Is there a problem with that? Can Ron change where he was born? Nope. Does that matter? And do you see how that connects again all the way back here to Abraham? If we see Abraham chosen for mission instead of chosen to be God's favorites, then we can critique this and say this is not good. This is not really what God wanted. If we don't see this, then we believe and we see the passages that make it sound like it's exactly what God wanted and say, hey, it's right here. David's a man after God's own heart. God loves the kings. It's everything God wanted. This is perfect. We should do and model our country after this time period, which might be happening even today. And what's the problem with that? Is this God's first will or second will? This is God's remedial will, not his best. This is God's best. God doesn't abandon us, right? God says, you would choose a human king? Okay, but I'll keep working with you, right? I'll keep working with you. And that's super important. I'm not going to abandon you. I'm not going to let you go. Eventually, the kingdom divides into two, and it splits into the northern kingdom of Israel, the southern kingdom of Judah. They both eventually are fall and conquered by somebody else. These are cool stories, and a lot of the stories that we hear in Sunday school and learn come from some of these time periods. But Israel, this is the thing that I learned again, that I thought I knew everything, and then I found out I knew nothing. Israel falls to Assyria in 722, and Assyria conquers them and takes about half of the people out and brings a bunch of other people in to mix up the people group, to make them all basically Assyrians. Does that make sense? Assyria is trying to create this big kingdom, and they're trying to make everybody Assyrians. So they, when they conquer a new people group, they mix them up. Most of the time, that ends whatever religion they had, whatever culture they had. But here, it doesn't. The people that they bring in and mix with these people creates a new people group called Samaritans. You all heard of Samaritans before? Yes. Did you know where Samaritans came from or why in the New Testament they're so hated? I sure didn't. I just knew that they didn't like them in the New Testament, but I didn't know why. Why don't they like them in the New Testament? Basically, it's this. It sounds harsh, but this is the truth. They don't like them because they're half-breeds. They're mixed. They're mixed ethnicity. They're not pure blood. So, because they've mixed here, but they remain faithful and keep worshiping God, keep worshiping Yahweh. Judah, on the other hand, if we could slide these boxes someday when the technology gets really great, I'm going to have it all automated. These boxes are going to slide down here to Judah because they keep those boxes and they make them even bigger. And they say, oh, look, guess what, Israel in the north? We have the temple down here. We have the kings in the line of David, and God loves David, right? Because he said there's going to be king on the throne in his line for the rest of all time. And we have the priest in the line of Levi. What do you got up there? Oh, nothing. God loves us more than he loves you, right? We're better. Especially when they fall in their mix, then they were, of course we're better. But, uh-oh, what happens? Eventually, Judah, your pride gets a hold of you, and you are conquered by Babylon. So Babylon conquers them and exiles 99% of the people in exile. Some of, again, these cool stories. Any of you know the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Daniel in the lion's den? Babylon, Babylon. Yeah? So, cool stories of faith, but even cooler when you find out they're exiled, they've lost everything, they think God left them and God doesn't care about them and doesn't want anything to do with them anymore, and surprise, because they're in a different foreign land, surely God can't love us in a foreign land, because we've been condemning them all along, right? And we've been telling everybody they have to come here and live in our land in order for God to love them, so God certainly can't love us now if we're exiled out in Babylon. But Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said, that ain't true. We're still going to follow God. And guess what? God showed up. Even in Babylon, God was there. Whoa. So, God still loved them, even in Babylon. There's some really great lessons and really great things that happen in Babylon, and I wish they would have held on to them super strong, but as soon as they get to go back, when King Cyrus, the Persians conquer Babylon and says, look, anybody can go back that wants to, they go back, and what do they start doing right away? They rebuild the temple. They rebuild the walls. And Ezra says, look, all of you that married foreign wives while we were gone, you got to get rid of them. Divorce them. What about our kids, Ezra? Psh, get rid of them too. They're half-breeds. We don't want them. We have to be really faithful to God. So this new box here we call ethnocentrism. It's basically a combination of these boxes, but it just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And I say now, you cannot understand the Gospels You cannot understand Jesus if you don't understand this box. Because this is the predominant, like, religious faith of the people, the Jewish people, as we get closer and closer to Jesus. God loves us. Why? Because we're Jewish. Because we're descendants of Abraham. We're pure ethnic blood of Abraham, right? Did Ezra forget parts of the story? Are they pure ethnic blood? No, they're not. No, they're not, right? He missed, he forgot a lot of these parts of the story. Yeah? And he missed this. God called them not to be chosen favorites, but to be what? Chosen for a mission, to bless all peoples of the earth. Ezra missed that. But if you read just the accounts of Ezra, it sounds like he's doing God's work. And I believe Ezra did do exactly what he thought. He did his best. But the story of Jonah directly contradicts that. And I wish I had time to go through the whole story of Jonah. But the story of Jonah directly contradicts Ezra. Because if you know the story of Jonah, most of the time we just stop at the, he got spit out of the fish. He didn't really want to go where he wanted to go. But do you all know where he was going? Nineveh is the capital of Assyria. Their enemies. So it wasn't just that he didn't want to go there because he was scared of them. He didn't want to go there because he says it literally at the end of the book of Jonah. Jonah says why he didn't want to go to Nineveh in the first place. And it wasn't because he was scared. It was because he knew that God was a God of love and that if he went to Nineveh, God would end up forgiving them, and he didn't want God to forgive them. That's why he didn't want to go to Nineveh. Whoo! Okay, that's good, huh? That's good stuff, man. What did you always said something? I can't remember now what it was. It just left me. Okay, that'll preach. Okay, so Jonah is here. This is when Jonah, and it's a direct contradiction to Ezra. So that box, ethnocentrism, keeps getting bigger and bigger. And when we get to Jesus here, Jesus is born to poor parents in Bethlehem. Yeah? Have you thought about the story of Jesus' birth? We celebrate Christmas every year, and it's like so cute, and we put up lights, and we have snow, and blah, 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 and it's all great, and we have little lambs and sheep. It's all great, right? Was it great for Jesus and Mary and Joseph? I'm just saying, if I was the creator of the universe, if I created everything there was, and I was going to send part of myself to be a part of that creation, would I choose a poor family, an unwed woman, and my kid to be born in a barn? If I'm honest, I'm probably not. I'm going to at least choose middle class. What's wrong with the little upper middle class? Really, right? We want him to be comfortable. Why would we choose? So the birth story of Jesus is good news for who? The rich and wealthy? No. The poor and the outcasts. The aliens. Why? Because not too long after Jesus' birth, what happens to Mary and Joseph and Jesus? They're on the run, right? They're on the run. They come back. Eventually, Jesus grows up in Nazareth, and eventually, at 30, we don't know much about Jesus' life. I wish we did. We don't actually have that many days of Jesus' life recorded in the Bible. It's only about 14, 15 days total that we can account of Jesus' life. Is that crazy in the four Gospels? That's not very much, right? But what we do know is we have a lot about Jesus' life. And Jesus comes back, he starts a ministry, he's baptized in the Jordan River by his cousin who? John the Baptist. And when he's baptized, Jesus is there in person. What comes down out of heaven? A dove, the Spirit. And then there's a voice out of heaven that says, "This is my son whom I'm well pleased." Yeah? His message, the words he says to us in English, are they really powerful and super meaningful? I mean, it's somewhat. Like, okay, he likes his son. That's cool. To the original audience and the people who heard that, it was really important because part of the phrase was the same phrase they used when they crowned kings kings, and part of the phrase had to do with prophets who really believed they were talking and preaching God's word. So what does it mean that Jesus is both a king and a prophet, a king and a servant? Jesus came to be a servant king. Jesus didn't come to rule the world and dominate over it, but to be a servant king. Is that different? That's different, right? Eventually, Jesus gets a group of disciples from various groups. He goes out to the wilderness and he's tested. But here's the thing that I am almost embarrassed to say in public and on recording. I grew up in the church my whole life. I went to church 3 times a week. I read the Bible through, I don't know, 5, 6, 7 times by the time I came to Heston. Again, I thought I kind of knew a lot, right? I, in my mid-30s, don't think I ever really thought about what Jesus actually said and did. Now, I know those of you that grew up in Mennonite churches your whole life are like, what are you talking about? But this is true for us non-Mennonites. We never really talked about what Jesus actually said and did. Most of the things that he said or did, he created miracles. He performed miracles. That's cool. What's the point of his miracles? To show that he's Messiah and he's perfect. But if we look at Jesus in context, the historic Jesus is super, super important. Why did Jesus perform miracles? What did Jesus say almost every time after he performed a miracle and healed somebody? Go and tell the whole world? Make sure everybody knows that I just healed you? No. What did he say? Don't tell anybody. Doesn't that kind of make you like, why would Jesus do that? That was weird, right? Jesus was challenging the religious leaders of his day. How do we know? How was he challenging the religious leaders of his day? He was healing people on the Sabbath. He was healing them outside of the temple. Jesus, you're not supposed to do that. The Jewish leaders of his day said the only place you could get healed is where? At the temple in Jerusalem. You had to bring a sacrifice and you had to go there. But here's the problem. If Jeff is born with a deformed arm, he's unclean. The only way for him to get healed from that arm is to go to the temple and offer a sacrifice and have the priest pray for him. But is he allowed to go to the temple by this time and offer a sacrifice? Nope, because he's unclean. Yeah? Some of the stories in there, the miracle stories of the blind and the lame, Jesus heals because they aren't going to get healed any other way. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Jewish leaders are angry at him, not because he can perform miracles, but he's performing miracles outside the temple, and now they're not getting their temple tax and their temple money, and he's ruining their business. Ooh, Jesus, I know. I have no idea what to do, Howard, because I feel like I could go another hour. But so Jesus died. Here, I will wrap up here in 3 minutes. This is super important because a lot of Christians believe Jesus came to earth, that God had it all planned. This connects all the way back here. That God had it all planned, that sin is a broken relationship between just me and God when I break one of the rules. So Jesus comes and dies as a perfect sacrifice to heal that one relationship. Versus this. What was sin? Four broken relationships. What's God doing to try and solve the sin problem? Create a chosen and covenant shalom people group out of all peoples. When Jesus comes, is he doing a completely brand new total thing that God never thought of before? Or is he joining in that same purpose, trying to create a chosen covenant shalom people out of all people groups? I think Jesus was, it seemed like brand new because the people had gotten so far away from it. But it's really kind of the same thing that he was doing here. Why did Jesus die on the cross? Was that what God wanted? God sent him here just specifically so he could die on the cross? Some of you might cringe, but I don't really think that that's it at all. I think he died on the cross because of the way he lived. He died on the cross because he challenged the government, he challenged the leaders, he challenged the oppression and the slavery and the poor things that were happening to all the people around them, and he wouldn't stop, and he wouldn't fight back. So what else are they going to do with him? They're going to kill him. Yeah? They're going to put him to death. So is there a spiritual side of it? Sure, and I love the spiritual side of it. He doesn't stay dead. He comes back to life. Eventually we get to Jerusalem conference, and here's the big kicker. So we say, look at this. Solution accomplished is not just Jesus. Also another thing that I had a hard time with, but I think it's really true. It's not just Jesus, because at Jerusalem conference, what's formed? Sorry. Pentecost, I skipped Pentecost. My mind's gone, I'm trying to hurry quick. Pentecost, who comes at Pentecost? The Holy Spirit. Yeah, the Holy Spirit. And the church is kind of started there. The Holy Spirit comes, fire, wind, just like back at Exodus. But eventually, people start wanting to join, right? Remember like Philip, the Ethiopian, right? The Ethiopian eunuch, wants to join. What do we do with all these people? Eventually they get to the Jerusalem conference and like, there's all these people that want to join and follow God, our God. What should we do with them? And Jerusalem conference, they finally get it. And they say, look, Jesus is Lord. What would Jesus have done? He'd have taken them in. He said, okay. So Jerusalem conference, we say, the church is formed and Jesus is Lord of the church. We should live nonviolently. We should love even our enemies. We should love God. We should love ourselves. We should create shalom wherever we can and challenge injustice where we can. This is the church. It's a new, crazy, radical new thing where people love each other, where women can lead and have value, where the rich doesn't matter. You open your home and you feed even the slaves and the poor and they come and sit at your table. That's crazy, right? That's crazy. That's the church. And the church here connects very, very similar, again, to what Jesus was trying to create back here. Shalom community, which connects all the way back to creation and the garden. Whew, I'm sorry. I knew I wouldn't get through the whole thing, but that's close. That's close. I better stop. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, and I, yeah.